I haven't really been successful at limiting that kind of consumption for myself. Hey folks, it's Carrie from Pretty Neat. Thanks for joining me. If you're new here to my channel, welcome. I share videos here every week about organizing and decluttering your home and just making your space the best it can be. So I hope that you'll hit the subscribe button and stick around. Today, I want to talk about purchasing habits. And the reason why I want to cover this is because I think this has such a big impact on the amount of clutter and disorganization that we have in our homes. If you are constantly buying stuff, bringing new things in, it just makes your efforts to get organized and to get rid of clutter that much more difficult. If you are constantly replacing the things that you're getting rid of with new things, then it's just this conveyor belt of stuff coming in and out of your home, and you're never really going to reduce the overall amount of things that you own. So I think it's important to examine our mindset around purchasing behaviors and to maybe try to adjust these a little bit. And I am putting myself in this category right along with you. I think that the situation that we're in right now with the pandemic is just making this so much more difficult for a couple of reasons. We're all buying so many things online now to avoid going to the store a lot. So we're just being exposed to more easy online purchases in that regard. And also, I think that many of us are just feeling the weight of this situation of the pandemic, and we're looking for some escape. We're looking for a little boost in our mood, and a lot of us use shopping to do that. And I think that's totally understandable, and I certainly fall victim to that sometimes as well. But it can get out of control, and if we're struggling with having too much stuff, it can really just make the problem worse. Let's think about the process of purchasing something and where the positive feelings come from in that process. Oftentimes, these are impulse purchases that we're making online. We see something either in an advertisement or we're browsing a website for something that we actually need, and something else pops up that looks fun and exciting or like something that we can't live without. And so we're tempted to buy it. In my experience, that's the point where the excitement of having that new thing starts to kick in. I start getting that little boost in my mood, and making that purchase is also an exciting part of the process. I also find that the waiting for the item to show up at my home is kind of the peak excitement level. So you're checking, you know, when is that thing gonna show up, and you're kind of waiting in excitement, anticipating this new item. So then the thing shows up at our home and we open it up, and that's kind of the pinnacle of the experience of getting this new thing. And that lasts for some period of time. But I don't know about you, most of the purchases that I make, once I've received the item, the excitement level goes way down. It drops after that. And I believe there's some research to support this, that the peak excitement is the anticipation of the thing, but the reality of the thing inevitably doesn't live up to our expectations. I talked about this a little bit in my last video when I talked about unwise purchases, those things that we are convinced are going to really make a big difference in our lives, but once we receive them, it turns out they don't, and then we just end up putting them away in storage and they become this object of guilt for us. So I'll link to my video about guilt down below where I discussed that. If we can keep this idea in mind that purchases very rarely live up to our expectations, we can maybe get ahead of this a little bit. So when we're browsing, rather than getting just caught up in the excitement of that thing, try to remember that that thing is probably gonna fall short once you receive it. And this might sound like kind of a downer, but I think it's just a way to help us mitigate that effect of getting caught up in the moment of buying something. I also find it really helpful in my own experience to put some barriers in place around my purchases. So whether this is like a dollar amount per month that I allow myself to make frivolous purchases, that might be one option to help keep those purchases in check and still allow yourself some of that fun. The thing that I have found that works best for me personally is to give myself a waiting period. So I'll give you an example of this. I was recently watching a video of some beauty YouTuber, which is something I spend a lot of free time doing. And that person recommended some products that looked really great. So I got excited about purchasing those things. And of course, I went to the website and looked them up, and they were actually available on Amazon. So I put that in my cart, that particular item, and while I was browsing, I came across another item that I remembered from some earlier video I had seen that was recommended, and I was like, oh yeah, I should get that too while I'm getting this. And I had them in my cart, and I was about to hit purchase, and I just stopped myself, and I reminded myself of how much makeup I already own, how infrequently I'm wearing makeup because I'm spending the majority of my time here at home right now. And I just hit pause. I put it in my cart, but I didn't buy it. And I have tried to create this habit for myself where I don't buy on impulse. I make myself wait a little bit of time. I find that giving myself at least 24 hours to wait on purchases really helps to take away some of that impulse and that excitement about purchasing the item. In the vast majority of cases, when I have gotten excited to buy something on impulse and I've made myself wait, I almost always forget about the item completely. There are very few things that I wake up the next day and I'm thinking, oh yeah, remember that eyeshadow palette? It's like out of sight, out of mind. And I just get excited in the moment. And I think this is something that a lot of people can relate to. Getting excited in that moment to buy something. If you give yourself a minimum waiting period on those impulse purchases, I think you will find that you don't end up buying a lot of them. And that once the initial excitement wears off and a day or two have gone by, they're probably not going to look that exciting, and like me, you will probably have completely forgotten about them. I like to use on Amazon, I have a save for later list of items, and I will often put things in there that I'm thinking about purchasing, and then every once in a while, I'll go through that list, or I'll be adding something, and I'll check. And I'm often surprised at the things that are in there. I'm like, oh yeah, remember that book or remember that gadget that you were gonna buy and that was a month ago and now you've lived without it all this time. It's just been a good reminder to me that the majority of things that pop up that I think are really important end up not being that needed. Another way that you can create a little bit of friction for yourself between having the impulse to buy something and actually making the purchase is to take your credit card numbers out of the autofill in your computer or on certain websites. If you have to actually go get your credit card and type in the number each time you make a purchase, that just adds a waiting period where you can maybe stop yourself as you're typing that number and like, maybe I should wait on this. I've gotten a lot of other helpful tips from the YouTube channel called Break the Twitch, and Anthony is the creator over there, and he talks a lot about breaking that habit of just purchasing things on impulse. I'll be sure to link to his channel down below. Another suggestion for reducing that urge for impulse purchases is to reduce your exposure to the source of the temptation. So for me, that is watching YouTube videos. Another area of impulse purchases for me personally is crafting supplies. And I just know that if I go into the craft store, I'm going to be tempted to buy stuff. And so by limiting my trips to the craft store, I just end up limiting the amount of stuff that I buy. So if you can just avoid those stores or those areas of the store that are really tempting for yourself, that's another way that you can reduce your impulse purchases. I just wrapped up a decluttering challenge over in my Facebook group. I'll link to my group down below because it's an awesome group of people and we're all on board helping each other get rid of clutter. But doing a decluttering challenge is really a good wake-up call about impulse purchases. I was taking a closer look at the things that I was getting rid of during that challenge. And again, a lot of those were like tech items, things that I bought because I thought they were really going to be helpful and they ended up not being. So whenever you drop off a box at the donation center or you're going through your home and you're getting rid of things, pay attention to the things you're getting rid of. You will probably see patterns there. And those patterns you can try to keep in mind the next time you are tempted to buy another similar item. Remember how many of those things you've recently gotten rid of, and you don't want that new purchase to just end up another discard item in a couple months. So I hope these tips about reducing purchases have been helpful. If they were, please hit the like button. It really helps my channel out. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel. I share videos here every week about organizing and decluttering your home and just making your space the best it can be. Talk to you soon.